the tandem. Sorry for the technical glitch. We'll continue the video. So we were talking about the Guru Shishya, physics of Guru Shishya, the relationship between the spiritual master and the disciple. First thing is that be in his breathing space. What you will learn with him directly, you won't be able to learn it online. There are many things that happen live, like mirroring of neuron life, initiation life, that cannot be given online. And just seeing him, how he lives his life, he will be a full example for you, and you will imbibe all his qualities. So Swamiji, next talk about the word Thyaag, like sacrifice. How when you sacrifice with heartedly, full heart with full of contentment, not like, oh, I have to do it, so I am doing it. No, doing it with completion, being complete our decision and then doing it. Like for us to come here, it was not easy. We all had our professional career, but dropping all here, come here, we are able to do it because we got the cognition being here with him will bring us more than being there alone.
Yes, and also you must feel that whenever you have done a sacrifice, that there is no pain, there is no nothing that
like,
is still.
Don't feel you're missing out on it.
Yes.
And you won't even feel it's a sacrifice. Yeah. That's so simple. So next two beautiful examples that Swamiji gave in a satsang was like really very touching, where I've never knew those stories before. So it was something completely new. First, he narrated the story of Ramakrishna. So Ramakrishna was a great devotee of Ma Kali. He had such a bhakti for Ma Kali, for that cosmic mother, that it even resulted in physical change in him. He even went to start having periods like women do, because he was imbibing that cosmic feminine forces so much that the change came by itself. You know, when you are so devotional, you have that intensity of you. You are praying to Ma like she's here, she's physical, she exists. Then she showers, she's with you. Anything can move when there's intensity for you. When there is the depth is there. You pray from your depth, from your depth dimension. Not, oh, I have 10 minutes, let me do a puja. 10 minutes, I can finish the puja and then start my day. Ah, it will be something good to start the day. Not from logic. Your depth should recognize it. Yes, I want to do this puja because she is my mother.
Yes. And once you do this routine, you imbibe these qualities. And it's only good that you have some good cognition that prayer or anything, puja, is part of you, and you will remembering your guru before starting your day.
Yes.
It will just give you some kind of energy.
It won't be a routine anymore. It's part of your life. Yeah. So Ramakrishna, he was so devotional to Ma Kali. When he started really invoking her, Swamiji said, when he was living in the ashram in Calcutta, it's still there, the deity is still there where he invoked and did the prana pratishtha of Ma Kali, where Ramakrishna invoked deity in that, invoked Ma Kali in that deity. Swamiji himself, 6 times, he has tried to bring a thread near the nose of the deity, Ma Kali deity. And he seen that how the thread moves, like someone normally
is breathing,
yeah. How the, when you have the breeze out, you will see how the thread move, breathing, breathe out, breathing, breathe out. So when we are talking about prana pratishtha, when we are saying we put life to a deity, it's not something fictitious. No, it's a truth. It's a science. It exists. And when you call the deity, he comes. He comes based on the depth that you carry in calling him. Yes. So what was shocking to me is today in this world where people are ready to spend like millions, like really ready to spend so huge amount of money because they want a gender change. And Ramakrishna, he didn't even know what is gender change. He only know he is with his mother, praying to her mother whatever samasa has as a quality, it just came in him and he was changing. So it was pure bhakti in a sense that it's a way to show how with your depth dimension, things can just move out of your imagination. Yes.
And also, whenever you have some deep willingness and that you want to do something with prayer, with whatever you call it, like sacrifice, you will see that God just shower on you. Even things that you may have fought for a long time, you will see that it just showers. So whenever you do with full integrity and also devotion, you will see that everything showers.
So when you take the stories of Ramakrishna and Mahakali, it's both-sided. You see, the son was ready, the child was ready, and the mother came. You know, the way you invoke her, she came and she is still here. So Mahakali is still here. Her presence is here in Calcutta and she's guarding everyone. And that's why so beautifully every year, during Navratri, she's invoked and she's prayed. So this was a beautiful story of Thyaga, of complete devotion to the master, to whom you consider as your guru and you're praying to him. Next, we'll move to our second story. This is a story of a Devadasi called Velli. So who are Devadasi? Normally in Vaishnav tradition, Vaishnav is when you pray to Lord Vishnu as your main deity. So we knew Krishna, he had so many gopi, gopika all around her. So we see that these are, in fact, those all the gopis was in fact Rishi Muni who decided to know. Nityanandam, I think you can follow us. Yes. So all the gopi gopikas around Krishna, they were Rishi Muni who decided to reincarnate with Krishna to enjoy his physical form here on earth. Yeah. So that relationship that they had between the Gopika and Krishna, that is the parampara of Vaishnavite. Praying to the Lord as your sakha, praying to the Lord as your best friend. In the 16 different type of way of praying, one is a dasi, sakha bhava praying. So there was a Devadasi called Velli. She was a great devotee of Ramanuja. We are talking about something around the early 30s, around 30s, when at that time the Mughal was attacking so many temples in India just to loot, in the intention of taking all the jewels, gold jewels, all the richness of temple. So Velli, being a very great devotee of Ramanuja, she was at the Ranganatha temple, and for her that place is her home. It's not a temple, because her whole life devotion goes around, you know, cleaning the temple, having the temple clean, performing Vedic dance only for the deity she loves. We are not talking about natural dance that we have everywhere in discotheques and wedding. No, we are talking devotional dance coming only from the depth dimension to your Lord or your God. So at that time, the Mughal attacks the temple, and then the main objective was to take the main deity, which was made of pure gold. They want to loot it. They want to just, take it and go away. So one of the priests decided he will take the statue and go and keep it safe in Madurai for some time till the Mughals are away from their temple, and then they can bring back the deity. This has been done several times ago. Even if you say at Vishwanatha temple, where the Shivalinga were there, five priests just took that Shivalinga and jumped in a well just to protect it. So this was a sacrifice, the Thyaga of our Brahman at that time, the priest at that time. Like they have been devoted their life for that God, and they don't want it to be touched by anything or anyone, or anything impure happen to them, because they represent the sanctity of Sanatan Dharma. People come and pray in front of them, and it was their dharma to protect it. So how Devadasi did her Thyaag? So the time was that the other priest, Pillai Kotacharya, is taking the main deity to safeguard it to Madurai. What she does in turn?
Yes, she did is to...
Sorry.
So what? Take,
what she does in turn?
Yes.
She started to do seducing that Mughal army, main army. So he seduced him, dancing, and she danced for several hours, bring him on the East Gopuram. Gopuram or normally that tower. You know, the traditional South Indian temple, you will see Gopuram, the four main towers all around. So she brought him to the tower, on the East Tower, and seduced him by her dance and all, just to buy time, so that the priest get time to keep away the main deity, the golden deity. And then she just pushed that Mughal priest, the Mughal, I don't know if he was an army officer or the main army officer, he just pushed him from the tower, okay. and she killed him. That shows the guts, that confidence that she have in protecting the temple, which was her own house, in protecting the Lord she worshipped. She didn't did it for any personal reason. Like imagine you going and seducing a Mughal who we knew what he did to the human woman race. She won't leave anyone. She did such really things, disgusting things that even can't be put in words, especially to the woman body. That they were not leaving a woman body. Such digressing things.
Yes, so.
She takes that. She knows what may be her fate if she doesn't act properly, if the act is not done properly. But she takes this risk, she does it, and she's finally able to kill him. Now the next step is one of the most deeper Thyaag, we can say. After killing that person, she herself just throw her body from the tower and commit suicide.
Yes. And recently I got the opportunity to travel with Swamiji to visit that place, and the priest was explaining and all this history, and that was a very very enriching trip, and we can feel that that Velli did, and this big temple has been done with lots of devotion, with lots of because everything is done with rock there.
So very architecture wise, yeah, it's very rich as a temple.
If you will go there, you will see huge. Everything is done with rock, and at this age, if you start building such a temple, it will take years to do that.
Very artistic.
And
very
also at that time, they did not have so much of technology. So it's like with some power, superpowers, and with some devotion, you can only build this kind of temple.
So coming back to the sacrifice of Velli, so now this Gopuran, the tower that exists in that temple, it's always painted in white, like a tribute, a memory for her sacrifice. So why she also decided to commit suicide? For the simple reason that whatever information she has with her, it ends here. The Mughal can't go further. So that where is the idol hidden? What is the next step? People can't probe. So that shows the Thyaga she had. So what Swamiji say, Ramanuja in himself, because she was a devotee of Ramanuja, he says Ramanuja in himself should be an incarnation for him to be able to invoke such a Thyaag bhav in a lady. It's not easy for a lady to come up in taking such a big decision.
Yes.
If she decided to make such a big move, that she was really impressed. But how great Ramanuja, he himself was as a master. So we end here. We hope you like these two videos. You understand when you have that bhakti, that depth, you can change everything, and you can bring things that you yourself will be shocked at. how are you able to do it? It's all happened when you have the grace of the master and you start painting from your depth dimension. Thank you for watching. Leaving around the master, that's the first lesson.
Yes.
Thank you for watching. If you have any question, do let us know. Nityananda.